So we have finished the first 10 suttas in the Majjhima Nikaya. We can go to the 11th sutta, Chula Sihanada Sutta, the shorter discourse on the lion's roar. But just let me recap what the Buddha said on the Satipatthana Sutta. This Satipatthana Sutta, it doesn't teach you exactly how to practice sati, you know. It just tells you the objects of sati, contemplating the body is, firstly, it says, to practice Satipatthana, you got to contemplate four things, body, feelings, mind, and Dhamma. And then the first one, body, it tells you the various types of bodies that you can contemplate. First one is the breath body. Then after that, the four postures. Then after that, awareness. Awareness actually is sampajanya, awareness of your body actions. And number four is the unattractiveness of the body and the 32 parts of the body. And then after that, the four elements. The fifth is the four elements. And then the sixth to the 14th object is the skeleton contemplation, the different types of skeleton. So there are 14 objects in the body. Then contemplation of feelings, there's only one. Whenever feelings arise and cease, you have to be mindful of it. Then contemplating of mind, the state of the mind, whether it's a lustful mind or an angry mind or whatever, be aware of it. I think this contemplation of mind, you can include also the thoughts, whatever thoughts arise, you have to be aware. But instead of following the thoughts, you don't follow the thoughts. If you follow the thoughts, you keep thinking, then you are no more mindful. Instead, you have to observe why you think in a certain way. What is your motive? And we look at the motive behind our thoughts, behind our reactions, then we understand ourselves better, whether we have a big fat ego or we have a lot of anger or whatever, we have a lot of greed. So it's only by understanding yourself that you can change. If you don't understand yourself, how can you change? How can you improve? That's why in the Noble Eightfold Path, the sixth factor, right effort is to always observe whether you have unwholesome states of mind or wholesome states of mind. In the same way, whatever thoughts come to your mind also, you should understand whether they are wholesome or unwholesome. And the contemplation of dhammas is to contemplate those dhammas that are very important in the Buddha's teachings. First one is the five hindrances, how the five hindrances hinder us from having wisdom. So we should try to get rid of them by meditation. And the five aggregates of attachment, this is an extremely important topic. We found in the Khanda Samyutta, the Samyutta Nikaya. Then the six bases, is the Salayatana Samyutta in the Samyutta Nikaya. And then the seven enlightenment factors is the Bojanga Samyutta in the Samyutta Nikaya. And then the four noble truths is the Saccha Samyutta in the Samyutta Nikaya. So the Samyutta Nikaya is a very, very important, to me, the most important Nikaya. It tells you exactly how to practice Satipatthana, how to practice the seven Bojangas, etc. Whereas this sutta, this Satipatthana sutta, just tells you the objects of sati. It doesn't explain exactly what is the meaning of sati or Satipatthana and how to practice. Okay, let's try to go through the 11th sutta, Chula Sihanada Sutta, the shorter discourse on the lion's roar. Thus have I heard. On one occasion, the Blessed One was living at Savati in Jeta's Grove, another up in Deeka's Park. There he addressed the monks thus, "Monks, Honorable Sir," they replied. The Blessed One said, "Monks, only here is there a recluse, a Samana, I think. Only here a second recluse, only here a third recluse, only here a fourth recluse. The doctrines of others are devoid of recluses. That is how you should rightly roar your lion's roar." So here the Buddha is saying, only in the Buddha's teachings, in the Buddha's asana, you have the first, second and third recluse, the first, second and third real monk. I suppose he says first, second, third and fourth maybe refers to the four types of fruits, fruitions, the Sotapanna, Sakadagamin, Anagamin and Arahanna. These possible monks, that wanderers of other sects might ask, but on the strength of what argument or with the support of what authority do the Venerable Ones say thus? Wanderers of other sects who ask thus may be answered in this way. Friends, four things have been declared to us by the Blessed One who knows and sees, accomplished and fully enlightened. This is Arahant Sammasambuddha. On seeing these in ourselves, we say, only here is there a recluse, only here a second recluse, only here a third recluse, only here a fourth recluse. The doctrines of others are devoid of recluses. What are the four? We have confidence in the teacher, that means the Buddha. We have confidence in the Dhamma. We have fulfilled the precepts, and our companions in the Dhamma are dear and agreeable to us, whether they are laymen or those gone forth. These are the four things declared to us by the Blessed One who knows and sees, accomplished and fully enlightened, on seeing which in ourselves we say as we do. So the Buddha says there are four things that they possess. They have confidence in the Buddha, the Dhamma, and they keep the Aryan precepts, and the companions in the Dhamma are dear to them. It is possible, monks, that wanderers of other sects might say thus, friends, we too have confidence in the teacher, that is, in our teacher. We too have confidence in the Dhamma, that is, in our Dhamma. We too have fulfilled the precepts, that is, our precepts. And our companions in the Dhamma are dear and agreeable to us too, whether they are laymen or those gone forth. What is the distinction here, friends? What is the variance? What is the difference between you and us? Wanderers of other sects who ask thus may be answered in this way. How then, friends, is the goal one or many? That means is the object one or many? Answering rightly, the wanderers of other sects would answer thus. Friends, the goal is one, not many. But friends, is that goal for one affected by lust or free from lust? Answering rightly, the wanderers of other sects would answer thus. Friends, the goal is for one free from lust, not for one affected by lust. But friends, is that goal for one affected by hate or free from hate? Answering rightly, they would answer, friends, that goal is for one free from hate, not for one affected by hate. But friends, is that goal for one affected by delusion or free from delusion? Answering rightly, they would answer, friends, that goal is for one free from delusion, not for one affected by delusion. But friends, is that goal for one affected by craving or free from craving? Answering rightly, they would answer, friends, that goal is for one free from craving, not for one affected by craving. But friends, is that goal for one affected by clinging, attachment, or free from clinging? Answering rightly, they would answer, friends, that goal is for one free from clinging, not for one affected by clinging. But friends, is that goal for one who has vision or for one without vision? Answering rightly, they would answer, friends, that goal is for one with vision, not for one without vision. But friends, is that goal for one who favors and opposes, or for one who does not favor and oppose? Answering rightly, they would answer, friends, that goal is for one who does not favor and oppose, not for one who favors and opposes. But friends, is that goal for one who delights in and enjoys proliferation, or for one who does not delight in and enjoy proliferation? Answering rightly, they would answer, friends, that goal is for one who does not delight in and enjoy proliferation, not for one who delights in and enjoys proliferation. Here, proliferation is papancha, means proliferation of thoughts. Monks, there are these two views, the view of being and the view of non-being. Any recluses or Brahmins who rely on the view of being, adopt the view of being, accept the view of being, are opposed to the view of non-being. Any recluses or Brahmins who rely on the view of non-being, adopt the view of non-being, accept the view of non-being, are opposed to the view of being. Any recluses or Brahmins who do not understand as they actually are, the origin, the disappearance, the gratification, the danger, and the escape, in the case of these two views, are affected by lust, hatred, delusion, affected by craving, clinging, without vision, given to favoring and opposing, and they delight in and enjoy proliferation. They are not free from birth, aging, and death, from sorrow, lamentation, pain, grief, and despair. They are not free from suffering, I say. Any recluses or Brahmins who understand as they actually are, the origin, the disappearance, the gratification, the danger and the escape, in the case of these two views, are without lust, without hate, without delusion, without craving, clinging, with vision, not given to favoring and opposing, and they do not delight in and enjoy proliferation. They are freed from birth, aging and death, from sorrow, lamentation, pain, grief and despair. They are freed from suffering, I say. Monks, there are these four kinds of clinging. What for? Clinging to sensual pleasures, clinging to views, clinging to rules and observances, and clinging to a doctrine of a self. Though certain recluses and Brahmins claim to propound the full understanding of all kinds of clinging, they do not completely describe the full understanding of all kinds of clinging. They describe the full understanding of clinging to sensual pleasures without describing the full understanding of clinging to views, clinging to rules and observances, and clinging to a doctrine of self. Why is that? Those good recluses and Brahmins do not understand these three instances of clinging as they actually are. Therefore, though they claim to propound the full understanding of all kinds of clinging, they describe only the full understanding of clinging to sensual pleasures without describing the full understanding of clinging to views, clinging to rules and observances, and clinging to a doctrine of self. Though certain recluses and Brahmins claim to propound the full understanding of all kinds of clinging, they describe the full understanding of clinging to sensual pleasures and clinging to views without describing the full understanding of clinging to rules and observances and clinging to a doctrine of self. Why is that? They do not understand the two instances. Therefore, they describe only the full understanding of clinging to sensual pleasures and views. Though certain recluses and Brahmins claim to propound the full understanding of all kinds of clinging, they describe the full understanding of clinging to sensual pleasures, clinging to views, and clinging to rules and observances, without describing the full understanding of clinging to the doctrine of self. Monks, in such a Dhamma Vinaya as that, it is plain that confidence in the teacher is not rightly directed, that confidence in the Dhamma is not rightly directed, that fulfillment of the precepts is not rightly directed, and that the affection among companions in the holy life is not rightly directed. Why is that? Because that is how it is when the Dhamma Vinaya is badly proclaimed and badly expounded, unemancipating, unconducive to peace, expounded by one who is not fully enlightened. Monks, when a Tathagata, Arahant Sammasambuddha, claims to propound the full understanding of all kinds of clinging, he completely describes the full understanding of all kinds of clinging. He describes the full understanding of clinging to sensual pleasures, views, rules and observances, and to a doctrine of self. Monks, in such a Dhamma Vinaya as that, it is plain that confidence in the teacher is rightly directed, that confidence in the Dhamma is rightly directed, that fulfillment of the precepts is rightly directed, and that the affection among companions in the Dhamma is rightly directed. Why is that? Because that is how it is when the Dhamma Vinaya is well proclaimed and well expounded, emancipating, conducive to peace, expounded by one who is fully enlightened. Now these four kinds of clinging have what as their source, what as their origin, from what are they born and produced? These four kinds of clinging have craving as their source, craving as their origin. They are born and produced from craving. Craving has what as its source? Craving has feeling as its source. Feeling has what as its source? Feeling has contact as its source. Contact has what as its source? Contact has the sixfold base as its source. The sixfold base has what as its source? The sixfold base has nama rupa, mentality, materiality as its source. Mentality, materiality has what as its source? Mentality, materiality has consciousness as its source. Consciousness has what as its source? Consciousness has volition as its source. Volition has what as its source? Volition has ignorance as its source. Ignorance as its origin. It is born and produced from ignorance. Monks, when ignorance is abandoned and true knowledge has arisen in a monk, then with the fading away of ignorance and the arising of true knowledge, he no longer clings to sensual pleasures, no longer clings to views, no longer clings to rules and observances, no longer clings to a doctrine of a self. When he does not cling, he is not agitated. When he is not agitated, he personally attains Nibbana. He understands birth is destroyed, the holy life has been lived, What had to be done has been done. There is no more coming to any state of being. That is what the Blessed One said. The monks were satisfied and delighted in the Blessed One's words. So in this sutta, the Buddha says that the real recluse or the real monk is only found in the Buddha's Dhamma Vinaya and the Buddha's teachings. And then if the external ascetics say that they also are similar, then the Buddha says, but the Dhamma Vinaya is different. So even these four things that they claim to have confidence in the teacher, confidence in the Dhamma, they have the precepts and they love their companions in the holy life. Even that is faulty because the Dhamma Vinaya is faulty. Then the Buddha says, talks about the four kinds of attachment or clinging, clinging to sensual pleasures, clinging to views, clinging to rules and observances, and clinging to a doctrine of a self. The Buddha says, these external ascetics, they are not able to explain these four types of clinging in detail. They might be able to explain one, or explain two, or explain three, but they are not able to explain all four correctly and in detail. Then after that, the Buddha says, clinging, the source of clinging is craving, source of craving is feeling, etc., just like in the dependent origination suttas. So that's the end of the sutta tonight. Anything to discuss? The source of the fear is our I am, the being. Once you have a perception that the I exists, then you are always afraid that this I may be harmed in any way. That's why all our fears arise because of that self. If there is no self, then there is no fear. That's why the Buddha says, an arahan, because he has no self. If you took a dagger, you wanted to stab an arahan, he will not shout for help. He does not see a self in this body. Even if you were to kill him, he would accept it as his karma. You see, if you practice meditation correctly, it doesn't matter what is your object that you contemplate on your meditation. But the aim of meditation is to attain the jhanas, to attain one pointedness of mind, to attain a focused mind. When the mind attains samadhi, there is strength in the mind. When there is strength in the mind, it doesn't move so easily. So it is not so much affected by fear or by sensual pleasures or enjoyment, anything. Even dukkha, it is not so much affected because it has a firm foundation, it has a firm base. So samadhi is very important, strength of mind. And understanding of the Dhamma also. If you have understanding of the Dhamma, then certain things we can accept. Like seeing these corpses and all that, although they are revolting, but the only way to overcome it is to see it again and again. You cannot say, oh, because it's revolting, I don't want to see it. Maybe when my samadhi is strong, then maybe I can see. Don't wait. You have to start getting used to it by seeing it. The other day, I understand they showed this asubha, this VCD, on how they kill people and all that. And then our one of our brothers, after seeing that, he couldn't sleep for a few nights, and he ran away home, went home for a few days before he came back. So, you see, this although this thing is revolting, hard to see, hard to stomach, but it's a fact of life. Life is like that. Life is really very cruel. So we have to come to terms with it. We have to face it. I always like to quote this, that when I was young, I had this fear of the darkness, because my parents brought me to see a Pontianak show, ghost show. It was so frightening. That after I came back, every night I had a nightmare for 7 nights. Every night I woke up sweating all over. And from there I got a fear of the dark. After I became a monk and then I went to Thailand, and I came back from Thailand in 1987, I went to look for caves to stay in Ipoh area. And I looked, I couldn't find a good cave. You know, all the good caves are taken up by people, by fortune tellers and by this and that and all. So some devotees went looking for me, and they found this dark cave behind Simpang Polai. A very dark and huge cave, bigger, I think, bigger than this hall. It seems during the Japanese occupation, in the Second World War, about 200 girls are hid in that cave. They were afraid of being raped by the Japanese soldiers, so they hid in that cave. So that was the best cave I had. So because it was very quiet, I went to stay there. It was very frightening. I could the first two nights I did not stay inside. I stayed outside. But then I had a dream that told me that I would be safe if I went inside the cave. Some devas appeared to me in the dream. So after that, I went to stay inside the cave. But it was so dark, I had to light an oil lamp. And sometimes some curious people came looking for me. I just blow off the oil lamp. I stand behind the rock. They look and look. They can't see anybody. So dark. So from there, I stayed there 4 months. Slowly, I overcame the fear of darkness. So it's like this. You want to overcome some shortcoming in you. You have to face it head on. You cannot run away. You keep running away until you die. So you never overcome your fear. Yeah, I mean, don't worry about your meditation not being up to standard. If you have, for example, a photo of a cut up corpse, and once in a while you peep at it, you're afraid, you put it away, and you peep at it again, keep peeping until you get used to it. Yeah. No. Not necessary. But if you are a person with a lot of lust, then it is advisable to contemplate on the corpse. You see, in the Noble Eightfold Path, the seventh factor is Sammasati, right? Right recollection. The eighth factor is Sammasamadhi, right concentration. Now, the seventh factor is only Sammasati. It's not Satipatthana, you know. A lot of people think that sati and satipatthana is the same. It's different. Sati and satipatthana is different. Sati is contemplating these four things. You can contemplate all four, or you can contemplate one of them. And you do this contemplation whenever convenient. For example, when you're sitting in a bus, as there's nothing to do, when you're taking a stroll, you just reflect on the Dhamma and you think of these four objects. You observe your mind, observe your feelings, and then remember the Dhamma that you have learned, and then observe your body and think of the nature of your body, how you're getting old, how 5 years ago you didn't have arthritis, now you got arthritis here and there. So then you realize the nature of the body, you know, and you contemplate, if you like, on the corpse, how you're going to end up as a corpse, and all this. So that is sati. But satipatthana is different. Satipatthana, the example given in the Samyutta Nikaya on how to practice satipatthana was this man who was forced to carry a bowl of oil, you know, among a great crowd of people. And a man followed him behind with an uplifted sword and told him, if you spill even one drop of the oil, chop off your head. So this man holding the bowl of oil, he has to be very mindful that he does not spill even one drop of oil. So he is walking with all his attention focused on that bowl of oil. That is how to practice satipatthana. And it's also mentioned very clearly in the Satipatthana Samyutta, when the Buddha talked about the simile of the cook, that the skillful monk who practices satipatthana, that means the one who practices satipatthana in the correct way, ends up with getting concentration. If he does not get concentration, then he's unskillful. He has not obtained the objective of practice satipatthana. The objective of practicing satipatthana is to attain the jhanas. That is the end result. So satipatthana is the link between samasati and samasamadhi. After you practice sati already, then you focus your attention on one object, for example, your breath. And as much as you can, put your attention on the breath, that one object. For the Buddha's disciples, they put their attention on the breath 24 hours a day. Even when they rest also, they have unremitting mindfulness on the breath until they are able to maintain their mindfulness 24 hours a day. And then they attain arahanthood. And then after that, the Buddha says in the Vinaya books that all arahants have mindfulness 24 hours a day. That's why they cannot do anything wrong. They cannot commit any fault, any break, any precept. So for arahant to be mindful 24 hours a day, he must have practiced to the extent that he could maintain his mindfulness 24 hours. So you cannot do that type of practice, maintain your unremitting mindfulness without samadhi. Without samadhi, you try to be mindful, very soon you'll be falling asleep. So that is the difference between sati and satipatthana. Satipatthana is the intense state of recollection, unremitting mindfulness on one object, moment to moment to moment to moment, and only one object, until it turns into one-pointedness of mind. That's why the Venerable Anuruddha, he was asked, what did you practice to attain such great supernormal powers? And he said satipatthana, intense state of recollection.
Indeed, the view of the cook who knows his master, actually, the cook and the master will be actually in the same degree, in the same consciousness of the mind.
Say again?
The cook and the master. Actually, the master is the mind, and the cook is the awareness.
Mm-hmm.
And then we are able to control our mind against the cook.
Yeah, but in this simile, it says that the cook has to observe the master's preference. So in the same way, when we are meditating, we have to observe what the mind inclines to, what the mind, like the type of meditation object that the mind likes, the type of conditions that the mind likes, like the place, the surroundings, the environment and all that. Yes. You have to be very observant of yourself. Come, we end here.